Good morning, everyone. We are gathered here for a student webinar session. Webinars gives us the opportunity to teach our leads and help them understand why a product is in the first place. A good teacher can inspire hope, ignite the imagination, and instill a love of learning. Let me welcome our faculty coordinators, Dr. Shanti Ma'am, Mr. Sampath Kumar Sir, Ms. Niranjani Ma'am, Ms. Saranya Ma'am, Ms. Gayatri Ma'am, and Ms. Pungudi Ma'am, who always supports and encourages us. Now, let me call upon Ms. Gayatri, Assistant Professor, Department of CSE, to deliver the welcome address. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Nikita. On behalf of our management, our principal ma'am, Dr. Subha Mohan Ram, Sri Ishwar College of Engineering, our HOD ma'am, Dr. R. Shubha, Department of Computer Science and Engineering, our respected faculties and our beloved students. I welcome you all for the Students Webinar Series 2021. All our dreams can come true if we have the courage to pursue them. All our dreams can come true if we have the courage to pursue them. Last year, we conducted Student Webinar Series 2020, Season 1 and Season 2 on our emerging technologies, both technical and non-technical topics, with around 2,500 participants in both sessions. We had a great involvement from our student speakers, volunteers, and also our faculty members. We feel extremely proud to start our Student Webinar Series 2021 with a fresh and energetic mode. It's a great honor for me to say that our students are growing more in all aspects, including their technical knowledge, passionate about their work, and also way of doing their activities should be always recognized and appreciated. Yes, we hope that this series will be a great start for them, where they can showcase their interest, explore their ideas, share their knowledge, and develop their skills in order to accomplish many things in this competitive environment. Before we would like to start our session, I once again thank you all for your greater support, and let us motivate our student friends to grow more at their higher levels during their career. Thank you. Over to you, Nikita.
Take the pleasure in welcoming HOD Sudha Ma'am to address the gathering.
Good morning once again to all of you. So happy to see all of you here in this platform. And today we are officially launching the first webinar of the student webinar series of this academic year. And I'm glad that two students from third year, Hari Krishnamurthy and Vishal, they have come forward and they are going to give us a seminar, which is actually a webinar on data science. And really, we are very happy that on such an students are very competent in such an upcoming area. And I think data science has not been covered in the curriculum so far. It is there only in the later semesters. But in spite of that, these students have taken efforts and they have did some self-learning, and also they have did some projects in data science, and that have given them the confidence and competence to address a group of students like this. So other students should take this as an example and try to develop your skills in and choose any one domain and try to get deep into the domain and be competent in that domain, because there are so many online resources available. And I believe that these two students, they have got an idea about data science and they became competent in data science, proficient in data science by referring to various online resources, and most importantly by doing projects. So this is the best model which will work for everybody. So try to associate yourself with any one upcoming emerging domain, because since we are in the computer science field, you all know it is a completely dynamic field, and every now and then there is some new technology coming into place. So try to associate yourself with any new technology apart from your academics. And academics is a different thing that goes in a different track, but equipping yourself in new technology, it has to be entirely taken care by you. And try to do some projects in those new technologies, which will make you very competent, and you can also deliver webinars like these two people. And when I was going through the webinar poster, like I was extremely happy to see that the two speakers of today, the two student speakers of today, they have put themselves as CEO of Innovation Geeks and one more position, Innovation Geeks. So they have this entrepreneurial drive, and they are venturing into a new company, and they have taken some steps to start a new company, which is very much welcomed by us. And we have, you all know that we have a startup accelerator Ignite, and most of the time students use it only for some other. So actually I was very much happy, not only myself, the entire department, the team, our team, we were happy that our third year students are venturing into a new dimension, and again the opportunities open. And as I was saying, we started Ignite with an objective to create more entrepreneurs in the institution, but most of the time it is used for some other activity, which is really pathetic. We have many times we feel very bad about it. And so others, you can also, you can take this as a drive, and you can start your own company, and the institution will be supporting you in all aspects. One of our seniors, they did this, and they are running. They are running. I mean, from the computer science department, a senior batch, a batch of students, four, five students, they started a company, and it is going well. And they use the Ignite as their office during the time when they were in the institution. So again, that is one avenue which is available for you. You can make use of that, like what Hari Krishnamurthy and Vishal did. You can also try explore this opportunity, and definitely working for a concern and giving work to so many people, there is a lot of difference. So you have to come to, we want you all to come to that level where you can give, you can create job opportunities for others. So you must have that as an ambition. Maybe for the time being, because of the other constraints you have, you can look forward to an opportunity to work in a company, but gradually you have to evolve in such a way that you must give job opportunities for others, and that should be your ambition. So saying all that, I wish the student speakers success in their new venture. And also I believe that this seminar will be useful for other students also. And again, the option is still open, the opportunity is still there. Those students who are interested in giving a webinar like this, you can approach your class advisor, approach Sampath sir and Gayatri madam, and there are other faculty in charges also. You can approach them and you can give your names, and definitely you will be also given an opportunity to share your thoughts. And always remember that knowledge, only when shared, it will grow. If you are knowledgeable and if you have it with yourself, there is no use out of it. Only when you share with other people, you will get to know about the you will get lot of insights about the technology that you know. So take this as an opportunity, and all the best to the student speakers. And I appreciate the efforts of the coordinators also in creating the poster. And I think the speakers, they have created a video, promo video also, which was very appealing, and that was shared in the groups. So once again, all the best to the speakers, and over to the MC. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Your motivational words always makes our students to think differently, also strengthen our creativity along with our knowledge. It's a great honor for me to start with our student webinar series on the emerging topic, data science. Data science has become a revolutionary technology that everyone seems to talk about. It is the study of data, and it's all about extracting, analyzing, visualizing, and managing and storing the data to create insights. Data science is greatly in demand and has a lot of opportunities. It enables companies to efficiently understand more data from multiple sources and derive valuable insights to make smarter data-driven decisions. We would like to hear more from our student speakers, Mr. Hari Krishnamurthy and Mr. Vishal of third year CSE, on a powerful webinar session on data science. Let me call upon MOC to introduce our student speakers.
It is a great honor for me to start with a student webinar series on the emerging topic, data science. Data science has become a revolutionary technology that everyone seems to talk about. It is the study of data, and it's all about extracting, analyzing, visualizing, managing, and storing data to create insights. Data science is greatly in demand and has a lot of opportunities. It enables companies to efficiently understand gigantic data from multiple sources and derive valuable insights to make smarter data-driven decisions. We would like to hear more from our student speakers, Mr. Hari Krishnamurthy and Mr. Vishal of third CSE, on a powerful webinar session on data science. They both are passionate about exploring new innovative ideas, fantastic troubleshooters, and also a data science enthusiast. Their achievements are, they participated and got selected among the top 20 teams in the first national hackathon on self-reliance-based intelligent India. Their team was one among the top 50 teams in the national level RTU Purnima Hackathon 2021 finalist out of 200 teams who participated in the finals. They secured third place in an intra-college event, Innovation Challenge 2020, conducted by Sri Ishwar College of Engineering. They both participated in Smart Tech Hackathon conducted by RTU. They also got selected for eBox intern at first year and earned a best performer. They also have developed many projects related to machine learning and artificial intelligence. Agrista connects farmers with industry. Third Eye monitors and analyzes a person's basic hygiene. COVID statistics accurate statistics about the rate of COVID infection and predicts its future trend. Safety money transfer, online money transfer system using a phase unlock system. Secure chat, a private chat for a college. They both earned many online course certificates in Python, machine learning, artificial intelligence, data science, Google Cloud Platform, web development, and digital marketing. Now, I call upon Hari Krishnamurthy and Vishal to start our webinar session.
So thank you, Nikita. So hi and hello, everyone. I'm Hari Krishnamurthy to start this presentation. And today's webinar topic is about data science, right? Without any further delay, let us start this presentation. So this is me. I'm Hari Krishnamurthy and founder and CEO of Innovation Geeks. Now, currently I'm pursuing my third year bachelor's degree in Sri Ishwar College of Engineering. And this is my LinkedIn ID. You can follow me over here. And this is my co-buddy, where he is the founder and director of Innovation Geeks. And he is also pursuing third year computer science degree in Sri Ishwar College of Engineering. So here is an agenda of the session. So first we're going to look at the data and data science use cases, then data science life cycle, then data mining task, and also we're going to see a live demo of data visualizations. So before going into data science, let us answer this question by what is data? Data is a collection of facts which convey some meaningful information. For example, look at these images. This is a green color call. This is an example for data. And another, this is my office. This is also conveys some meaningful information which can be attained as data, right? So data can be a number, it can be in a form of words, or it can be in form of images and also in video. Right now, the boom of the internet in social media, the most of the data in internet are images and videos. Look at the social media such as Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. There's the most of the data are in the such forms like images and videos. Over the day, the millions of images are uploaded in Instagram, and millions of images are videos are uploaded in YouTube, right? So let us understand data back then and data now. Data back then, which is before 30 years ago, was basically a small structure, small, and their structure where they were using a floppy disk, which is only 512 kilobytes, not even megabytes, right? It is extremely low, which is 512 kilobytes. Over that time, there is no social media, and so the data are stored in a single format and structure. Structure, which is mean by they are tabulated within the rows and columns. And really, that time, they have no motive to analyze the data. But now, data which we have now is exponential growth of social media. We have terabytes of data, which is generated every day, right? So what is mean by unstructured data? So data which is not present in a rows or column format. So data which is not directly fit in a tables are called unstructured data. So the data, very important to leverage the data for the health. So what are we going to do with a huge amount of data? So we are supposed to utilize this data and answer business question. So the data science comes here, where we're going to use all those data and going to analyze the data. For example, we can consider these scenarios, like we can increase the revenue of a company, or we can increase the sales of a product. Even we can control the outbreak of a disease, right? Now we are facing a pandemic called COVID-19, right? So data scientists have their own part where controlling the outbreak of COVID-19, right? So the data science have its wide number of domain and its application. So let us look into some of the applications of data science. Consider the scenario where you are in India and you got a call from a bank that your transaction of 1 lakh rupees out of in an USA, right? Purchasing some gadgets. So the problem here is you are not out of India and you are not been to USA, and you have never spent more than 10,000 rupees on your credit card. And how do your bank do this? And how do they able to find that fraudulent transaction is made over here? So the bank staff ask you to verify whether the transaction is made by you. So the bank were using some data science algorithm at back end and comes to know it is a fraudulent transaction, where they were going go through all the data and all the transaction made by you. By go through all the transaction, they would know that generally you would not spend more than 10,000 rupees. So you would have used the credit card out of India. When the data science algorithm see this transaction, it makes a decision that it must be a fraudulent transaction, and you will get a call of verifying from a bank account, bank staff. So let us consider another scenario. I hope you all will have a Gmail. So consider this one. If you look at the Gmail application, there will be a different sessions, right? There will be a general section for normal mails. There will be a spam session for spam mails, and there will be a promotions and some other session too. How do Gmail know this generic mail or a spam mail or promotion mail? Again, Gmail is using some data science algorithm and data science technique at a back end. So basically Gmail does is it is using a text mining or text analytics algorithm. It will get mail consistent. These things, the most of the spam mails contain the subject which has exclamatory mark, or entire subject will be in a caps lock, or you will have these terms like related to promotion, prize one, or donation. And also the some things content. So Gmail will have a dictionary which it should have a positive dictionary and a negative dictionary. The negative dictionary might contain a word which is might be a spam. So it counts the word of each and everything in a subject and in a content. And if the count of the word of spam increases threshold value, then Gmail will tell, it will determine that the mail is spam. And this is how the spam mail works. So let us get into data science lifecycle. Data science lifecycle comprises of the following step: data acquisition, data pre-processing, applying machine learning algorithm, evaluation of pattern which we get after the application of machine learning. Then last, we need to represent or we need to show the result. It is over here. So at first, let us start with the data acquisition. As I had told you, that data present in this world are unstructured and present in a multiple source. If we had solved a data science problem statement or a business statement, we have to collect the data from multiple sources. It can be a data entry method or a website database, or it can be a web scraping. And it can be in any formats like PDF, doc, or sheets, even SQLs. So the problem is we have the data in multiple format and multiple structures. Now we need to integrate this data into a single format. We will be storing this data in a single format in a data warehouse. So that is called as data storage. So now after we have integrated this data, we need to find our targeted data. Whenever we are collecting a data for a business statement or a data science problem statement, we are not sure that all the gathered data are useful for us. So in this step, we'll be finding the targeted data and we'll be removing the unwanted data. So once you have acquired the data, we have to pre-process the data. So the stage is known as expansion data analytics. And this stage is this stage is where the data science lifecycle takes most of the time. If you have a bar chart of 0 to 100, about 40 to 60% of entire data science lifecycle will be spent for data pre-processing. Because what do we have now in our hands is only the raw data, right? So we need to convert it into an tidy data. So under data pre-processing, we have two branches like data manipulation and data visualization. So let us see an example. In a college, there is a list of students. So the work given here is to extract the who scored above 80% in their 12th grade or 70% in their diploma. So the process of extracting this data is called data manipulation. And let us consider the same sheet where you're supposed to understand the sheet. Do we understand just by looking the sheet? Obviously not, right? So what can we do is we can plot the data under a bar chart or scatter chart. Even you can use a pie chart. So by looking the picture, we can understand the data instead of the numbers or words. Picture can say thousands of words. So visualization is extremely powerful in data science lifecycle. So this is how the data pre-processing stage. Now we have a tidy data, and the data is ready to build a machine learning algorithm. So let us understand what is exactly machine learning algorithm. So as I have defined here, application of intelligent algorithm to find useful and meaningful information from the data. It is termed as machine learning. So if the problem statement asks you to classify the groups, you will be using some classification algorithm. If the problem statement is asking you to predict something on basis of something, you will be using some regression algorithm. Or else if the problem statement asks you to cluster the data into different groups or cluster the data into different segment, you will be using clustering machine learning algorithm. Example for classification algorithm is, you can say like, if you have a picture, you need to classify the picture is a cat or dog. This is a simple example for a classification algorithm. For regression, we can say like, we can predict rainfall of a year. Example for clustering is categorizing an item of an e-commerce site. It is an example for clustering. So after applying this machine learning algorithm, you will be obviously have an result, right? But we cannot be sure that the result which we have is correct or useful for us. So you have to evaluate this result, and this stage is known as pattern evaluation. So whatever the result you had a raw data, you had a tidy data in here, and you have applied some machine learning algorithm. After we apply machine learning algorithm, we'll be getting a result. We need to evaluate this result properly. So what we will do here is we'll be check the correctness and the usefulness of the result. So let's say the accuracy of the result is less than 40%. You have built a model and done all the work, but the accuracy of the model is not satisfied. We'll be not considering this model as a good one. So what we'll do is we'll be come again with a data science life cycle from the first stage. So if the model does not solve the problem statement, then there is no point of using the result. So the main thing should be keep in mind is we need to give an accuracy of higher level. So after the pattern evaluation result, if you see the result, the correctness, and then determine the final result, right? And we have the fine knowledge representation. So once you got the result, you have shown the result with a simple anesthetic graph to a stakeholder or a client. And the stage is known as knowledge representation. The reason why do we represent through graph is the client might not be technologically savvy, so they can't understand the technical terms in the result. So we have to make it simple, and by using anesthetic graph and adding highlights in the graph, which you find in the machine learning, and we'll be finalizing the result with some graphs, we'll be showing to our stakeholders. So here is an end of the data science lifecycle. Now let us get to know about anomaly detection. Anomaly detection is nothing but identification of unusual pattern or outline helps in understanding the data. Normally, anomaly detection comes under data pre-processing. Let us consider a scenario where we are in a COVID situation, right? So due to COVID situation, the medicine called remdesivir has dramatical increase in its price, right? So if you plot price amount of this medicine in a time scale, will be increasing at a certain point. We need to figure out this point, and we need to look into the data, and we need to clear this data, because this is an illegal activity in machine learning, right? So not only this, the data set might be contain some null value. We need to clear the null values. So next one is association rule mining. This method is used to find out interesting association among the different entities. Let us have an example, and diaper and a bear asynchronization. Research and determine the result like a dad around 30 years old, they would buy a diaper for his baby, and also he buy a case or a can of beer. So there is a relationship between these any two or more elements. And now could also we can see in our e-commerce site, like if you buy an iPhone, the Amazon or Flipkart will suggest you to buy an AirPod or iPhone charger, right? This is a best example for associated rule mining. So for now, I hand over this session to Vishal. I'll be continuing my session in a live demo of visualization. So hand over this session to Vishal.
Thank you, Hari Krishnamurthy. Am I audible?
Yes, Vishal, you are audible.
Okay, sir. So greetings to one and all present here. I am Vishal from third year CAC department. Data science is one of the most in-demand technologies right now. This is probably because we are generating enormous data at an unstoppable pace. Now, without any further delay, let's move on to the topics that I'm going to cover today. We'll be seeing the difference between AI, ML, DL, and data science. We will be seeing what this means by modeling stage in data science. We'll be seeing SAR model in detail and a live example of SAR model. And finally, we will be seeing the scopes for data science and what are all the skills required to become a data scientist. So now, many of us have the confusions like what exactly is AI, ML, DL, and how are they interrelated to data science? Like number subjects, we would have come across the term AI, ML, but many of us doesn't know what is the difference between these types and how are they interrelated to each other. So let us go ahead and see some Venn diagrams. Let me consider this circle as a Venn diagram for AI. Now, what is AI? AI or artificial intelligence is the ability of a computer or a robot to perform certain actions by itself. AI basically enables or makes your machine to think. That means without any human intervention, the machine will be able to take its own decision. AI is classified into many types, like based on capacity, it is classified as weak AI, general AI, and super AI. Based on functionality, AI is classified as reactive machines, limited memory, theory of mind, and self-awareness. But today we are going to see about weak AI, general AI, and super AI. Now, what is weak AI? All the current prevailing AI machines as or AI applications comes under the weak AI. Weak AI is also referred to as narrow artificial intelligence. And it is the only type of AI that we have successfully realized to date. Weak AI is goal oriented such that they are designed to perform only singular actions. For example, let me take self-driving cars. The self-driving AI only helps to self-drive the car. So you could say this AI operates under a narrow set of limitations or instructions. Weak AI has experienced tremendous growth in the last decade. For example, weak AIs are now used in a medical field for diagnosing cancer with an extreme accuracy. Now let's move on to the general AI. General AI is the concept of a machine with general intelligence, which mimics our ability to mimic the human behaviors. That means it has the ability to learn and apply its intelligence to solve any kind of problems. It is also called a strong AI. And it is not achieved yet in this world. Scientists consider human brain as a model for general AI, and hence building general AI is a tedious challenge. A company named Fujitsu built a supercomputer called K Computer, and which is considered as an attempt to build general AI. But still, it is not considered as a general AI because it took nearly 40 minutes to stimulate a single second of neural activity. That means our brain la one second of neural activity stimulate pandradhukku vandu in the K computers it took nearly 40 minutes. So you'll be wondering that how big is our brain. Let us move on to the super AI. Super AI is a hypothetical AI. It is different from other AIs. That is, it doesn't just mimic or understand human intelligence. In fact, it surpasses the human intelligence and the human capacity. You all would have come across this super AI in many sci-fi films like Terminator, Age of Ultron, etc. But this type of AI is not likely to be achieved because general AI itself is not achieved yet. So that's all about super AI. Now, let me consider this black circle as a Venn diagram for machine learning. And now, what is machine learning? Machine learning is a subset of AI. It is the scientific study of algorithms and statistical models that a computer used to perform specific tasks. Moreover, ML provides us statistical tools to explore the data. Like AI, machine learning also has certain types like supervised ML, unsupervised ML, and the last technique is known as reinforcement ML. Let us see these three kinds of ML here. In case of supervised ML, we will be having some labeled data, that is some past data. With the help of this data, we will be able to do prediction. Let me give you an example. Like suppose I have two features in my data set, like height and weight, and I want to classify whether a person belonging to an obese category or a fit category. Here in this scenario, I will be having the past data with output. So I will be able to create and train my data, thereby it creates a supervised ML model. When it comes to the second category called unsupervised ML, I won't be having any labeled data. This means in my data set, I won't be having any outputs. So in unsupervised ML, we will be solving clustering kind of problems. Now, what exactly the clustering does is, it will try to group the given data with given data together based on the similarities between each data. So there are different types of clustering techniques available in the world, like k-means clustering, etc. Now, when it comes to reinforcement machine learning, what will happen is that some of my data will be labeled and some of my data will not be labeled. So in this case, the model will compare both labeled and unlabeled data, and based on the comparison, it predicts the output. I hope you all understood what is ML and what are the main techniques in ML. Now, let me consider this red circle as a Venn diagram of deep learning. Now, let us see what is meant by deep learning. Deep learning is a subset of machine learning. It is the field of study that gives computers the capacity to learn without being programmed. At the initial stage, the scientists thought of replicating the human brain's function. So this is how the concept of deep learning was first of all born. In human brain, there are billions of neurons present. Likewise, in deep learning, you will be creating architecture, which is called as a multi-neural architecture. It is the main concept in deep learning. In multi-neural network, you are having various kinds of techniques like ANN, artificial neural network, CNN, convolution neural network, and at last, RNN, recurrent neural network. Let's see what are these ANN, CNN, and RNN. Now, artificial neural network. Let me consider I'm having a data set in the form of numbers and mathematical expression. Then I will be using artificial neural network for predicting output. ANN have the capacity to learn weights that map both input to the output. The activation function introduces nonlinear properties to the network. So this helps the network to learn any kind of complex relationship. Simply remember that our data is numbers or illa mathematical expressions how irundhuchna we would be using artificial neural network. And when it comes to convolution neural network, suppose our input is in the form of images or videos, then we will be using convolution neural network. CNN is widely used in image and video projects. In fact, our team used CNN in our face mask detection project. Here I consider that I have labeled both dogs and cats photos, and if I pass a cat photo into the network layer, it passes through several neural layers, and finally the machine finds that it is a cat's photo. This is how the convolution neural network works. Simply remember that when it comes to convolution neural network, you would be using the data in the form of images or videos. Now let us move to recurrent neural network or RNN. Now if our input is in the form of time series kind of data, then we will be using recurrent neural network. For example, weather forecasting is done by using recurrent neural network. So that's all about deep learning and neural networks. Now the question arises like, where does the data science actually fit into this? So data science is a technique which applies all these parts, like it has some ML, DL and AI functions, along with it has some mathematical tools like statistics, probability, linear algebra, etc. So yeah, data scientists should be well versed in all areas like ML, DL, AI, etc. Now we are going to see in detail about what is in the modeling stage in data science. Modeling means formulating every step and gathering the techniques required to achieve the solution. In modeling process, there's three main processes, namely feature engineering, model training, and model evaluation. We will be seeing a feature engineering and model training today. Before getting into the feature engineering, there was a study published by Forbes magazine on what data scientists spend most of their time. And the study results showed that they spent majority of their time in cleaning their data. Because in the real world, the data looks pretty messy. And feature engineering is something that helps you with data cleaning. Feature engineering is the process of making or converting your raw data set or data into an usable data set. For example, you could use it for training the model. It is an important concept in data science, and without this, you won't be able to predict with accuracy. Now, feature engineering consists of lots of techniques for improving your data set. But today we are going to see about only three techniques. They are how to handle outliers and what is meant by one-hot encoding and what is meant by missing values. Now, what are outliers? Let me give you an example. Let's say you are studying home prices, and these are the home prices in Coimbatore. And on seeing this data set, you would find that there is an error in the data set, like the value of the fourth entry is too low, and it does not match to the other entries. These kind of error entries are called as outliers, and these errors results in uneven prediction. Here the data is too small, so we found out easily. In the case of large data, we will be using some techniques like visualization or some mathematical concepts like two standard deviation to spot the outliers. And what is the one-hot encoding? One-hot encoding is a method of simplifying your data. Here we will be using, maybe replacing the text data with numeric data for reducing the size of the data. So this is about one-hot encoding. And what's mean by missing values? In large kind of data, we would find lot of null values or missing values. The common method used in handling this type of missing values is filling the missing entries with average values. So this is about missing values. Now, what's mean by model training? After cleaning our data, we must select a model for training based on our needs. There are many models that data scientists have created over the years, and we have seen many models in machine learning. And today I'm going to introduce a specific model to you. Yes, that is SAR model. SAR model is mainly used in epidemiology, that is the study and analysis of diseases. It is used to analyze how an infection spreads across the population over time, and it also used to predict the future trend of the certain infections. Now, the SAR model consists of three compartments, namely the susceptibles, the infected, and recovered. Now, let's see what is meant by susceptibles. Susceptibles are all of the people who are capable of becoming sick from an infection. For example, if we take COVID as an infection, that then everybody in this world would be regarded as susceptible. So, now let's see what is meant by infective. So, if a person who is from susceptibles is infected by the infection, then he moves on to the infection category. Now, in the case of recovered, we will be having people who are either recovered from the infection or died due to COVID, and those people would be moved to the remote category. Now I am going to consider this as the rate of change of expressions with respect to time, and I am considering ds by dt as my rate of change of susceptible with respect to time. Now you could see that there is a negative signature here. This is because the susceptibles are becoming smaller as time goes on, and A is a constant, and now the susceptibles are converted into infected by contact with each other. So there is an S multiplied with I, that is susceptible multiplied with infection. Now let us consider the DI by DT as rate of change of infected with respect to time. Here the ASI indicates the people who have came from the susceptibles. And minus BI indicates the people who would be moving to the recovered stage. Now, let me consider DR by DT as the rate of change of recovered with respect to time. And the RI is the people who are leaving from the infected and moving to the recovered stage. So these three are the mathematical expressions of susceptibles, infected, and remote categories. And this is the graph we will be plotting by using this mathematical expressions. And the main use of this mathematical expression is to find R naught value. Now, what is meant by R naught? R naught is a mathematical term that indicates how contagious an infectious disease is. It's referred to as. Please do. Mute your mic. R naught is a mathematical term that indicates how contagious an infectious disease is. It's also referred to as the reproduction number. For example, if a disease has R naught of 18, then a person who has the disease will transmit it to an average of 18 other people. So if the R naught value of a certain infection is lesser than 1, then the disease will decline faster. If the R naught value is equal to 1 for a certain disease, then there will be a spread of disease, obviously, but there won't be any pandemic situation. If the R naught value of a disease is greater than 1, then there would be a pandemic situation. You would be wondering that what R naught value would COVID have. The COVID has an R naught value of 5.526. So, as a result, if a person is infected by COVID, will transmit it to an average of 6 other people. So, let us see the live example of SIR model. Is my screen visible?
Yes, Vishwan.
So this is the website that our team has developed recently. This COVID statistics is a portal that gives accurate statistics about the rate of infection of COVID-19. We have added a feature of COVID prediction in our website. Now let's see its working demo. I use the SIR model to predict the future trend of COVID. Let me predict for India. So this is the prediction of the confirmed cases in India, which will be this total amount of confirmed cases in India, which would be in after 7 days. And this is the predicted number of deaths, total number of deaths after 7 days in India. Likewise, you'd be having for all each other countries like, 1 second. If I take United Kingdom. So you'll be getting the predictions like this. These graphs use SAR model to predict the future trend of the COVID in selected countries. Let me show you the back end now. So this is the back end of my website. It took nearly 2 months to code these lines here. If possible, I would take a private session for explaining this code line by line, but right now explaining this code line by line takes several minutes, so I'm going to skip it now. So these are the live example of SAR model. Now let's move on to the scopes and skills required to be a data scientist. Now first of all, why data science? As you all know, data is the fuel of the 21st century. We are generating enormous amount of data, like in social media, emails, business models, etc. So data science is a huge trend nowadays. And an average data scientist in India earns up to 5 lakhs to 8 lakhs is the average salary. And the highest paid would be about 20 lakhs to 30 lakhs per annum. And the data science is highly flexible, so that data science is applied in every field, like you would be having in travel agencies or in online shopping, you would be having data science. In everything, you would be having data science. And there is a huge demand for data scientists in many countries. So these are the reasons why we have to pursue our higher degrees in data science. Now, these are the in-demand data science careers, so like data scientist, you have machine learning engineer, you have applications architect, you have enterprise architect, and you have data engineer here. Still, there are many more careers in data science, but these are the high paid careers in data science. There are many opportunities across this globe, like US holds the upper hand when it comes to AI and data science salaries. According to recruitment specialists, UK has a huge demand for AI and DA skills. China has also an upper hand in AI and data science, and India and Canada are growing at a faster rate in the field of data science, and lots of opportunities are there among these countries. Now let's move on to the, now let's see the skill sets required for the data scientist in India. These are the skills that data science companies are demanding right now. Most of the companies are asking for SQL, Python, and R has even become outdated nowadays. Many of the companies started to demand Julia. The experts predict that Julia is going to be a good hit in upcoming years. So these are all of the required skills for a data scientist. So that's it from me. Over to Hare Krishnamurthy. Thank you.
So thank you, Vishal, for your wonderful presentation. Now let me share my visualization of COVID-19 predictions. So I think my screen is visible now, right? So let me start from here.
Yes, sir, your screen is visible.
Well, thank you very much, sir. So here are my dependency and required libraries. So I have imported. Then these are the data which I have gathered from my GitHub pages. So let me get into the visualization effects. So first, let us have a look of active and death, and also recovery cases. Now here we can see the clearly we can see that around 35% of active cases and around 62% of recovery cases and around 2% of death cases in the current scenario. Now let us get into hotspots, which means which will be having a higher COVID cases. Here are 12 countries which has the highest cases. So let me copy it first. So let us plot them in a graph where red indicates their death cases and gray indicates their recovery and green indicates their active cases. Well, some of the countries have flattened their curves like USA, Russia, United Kingdom and also Spain. But other countries like India, Brazil, Turkey and Russia, they have their curves extending. So this is what we predicted in our first scenario. Let us make a note of it. First is US and UK, Spain, and what else I missed? What I missed is France. They have flattened their curves, and apart from this, have India and Brazil, and we have Turkey, and we have Russia, then we have Italy, then Argentina, and Colombia, then Spain, Spain is in Germany. These are the countries they haven't flattened their curves at the top level, right? So next we have we can analyze the death rates in our last 3 days. So we can clearly see that death per rate for million, India has the lowest rate according to per million in the death cases in last 3 days. But in some countries like Brazil or Italy, they have highest cases. So next we can calculate the spikes of the hotspot countries. This is in millions and according to date. Date from around May to June, we have our cases over here. We have gradually increasing our confirmed cases and recovery cases, and also as well as the death cases too. And also now let us compare with the countries. This is how we compare. So US has highest the rate of increasing and comparing with other countries, and also India is the second leading in increasing in the rate. So let us plot. Let us now you can look into India. So here is our table where we have plotted. So let us see. Maharashtra has a leading confirmed cases and in most of the cases, and I think active cases in Karnataka and Tamil Nadu are really increasing, and death per million, death per 100 is really high in Punjab, right? So, and Uttarakhand is also highest. So then in the graph of the states of India, so most of the states flatten their curves. They are gradually decreasing, but in some states like Tamil Nadu, we haven't decreased our spike into half. Then we have Karnataka, then Kerala, and so. And also Andhra Pradesh and some more states. So let us have a growth rate of some countries, some states. I'm sorry. So here we can see clearly. We can see some of the states have gradually increasing and decreasing the rate of increasing in cases. Initially, there is increasing and decreasing of case. This is before a year back. That is, but we can see over here there is a rise in a rise in a second wave. So most of the states will be having this curve. Next, we can compare with the population of India. So the Delhi has the highest population fall in the last 3 days, and Tamil Nadu will be in the mid of some 200 and 300 over here. And can compare the hospitals in India, but this data is too old. We have updated our hospital data, but let us visualize these things. So primary health center will be around this range, and community health center will be in this, and also some total public and district hospitals are in this range, and urban and rural health facilities are in this level. And also, this is also updated in recent days, and daily there is an increasing in hospitals and beds. So we can't consider this, but when I was applying my machine learning algorithm, this is the latest data which I had. And also testing center in each states, right? And each states, Mumbai has the highest positive confirmed cases, positive confirmed in their test cases. So then ICR test of each center. Mumbai has highest test center in their states, and followed by Tamil Nadu, Telangana, and Karnataka. So next we can get into predictions. So as per the date, today's the average growth factor of the confirmed cases is one. The factor of increasing is one. So predictor for next 15 days is visualized over here. We'll be having around this in lakhs actually. We'll be having 5.2 lakhs over next 15 days. This is just a linear prediction, but it may get some deflection in the cases actually. So after plotting these cases, we'll be having a prediction around 3 million at the end of this month. So this is how we predict and visualize this for an data science. So hereby I'm ending this visualization. So thank you for our management to giving this opportunity to share our ideas in this session.
Thank you, Hari Krishna Murthy and Vishal. Participants, you can post your queries over here in the chat box.
What are the best online courses you can suggest to our friends to study artificial intelligence and machine learning and data science?
Okay, you can choose some. You can learn by your platforms like Coursera, Udemy, even like I will suggest Data Camp or a data like. Data Camp or Data Coggle. You can learn from Coggle. That is very useful, where I have started my machine learning career in a Coggle, right? So it is very well useful for beginners. Any other questions?
Thank you. How to make a data science projects from scratch? Any suggestions to start with?
It's clearly based on your interest. You must find what's your interest in that area. And even Hari Krishna Murthy is interested in ML machine learning, and he built a face mass detection model. And right from the beginning, I was interested in mathematical terms, algorithms. So I was studying from the basics of data science, and finally I achieved in building a website. So it's clearly based on your thoughts and inspiration towards data science will make you to build a new project.
My suggestion is you can start from very basic, like learning Python, Python libraries like NumPy, Pandas, visualization libraries like Matplotlib, Seaborn. Then you can get into data machine learning libraries like scikit-learn, scipy-learn, then PyTorch, TensorFlow. Then you can get into Coggle, then you can solve some business or data science problem statement or Coggle. Then you will be able to solve, get to know how to solve a machine learning problems. So some other questions.
Okay, this is Sampath here. Many of the attendees are asking that whether they will get the session recording. I hope you have shared your email IDs while you are entering this room. We will send you a recording or recordings of the session to you. Okay, and there is a query to Hari and Vishal. One of our participants have asked how to collect the data sets, where to collect the data sets.
There are lots of data sets available in GitHub and Coggle, sir. So they could search their what kind of data sets they required in GitHub and Coggle.
So over that, we can use a data entry method, sir. We can simply take a sheet, then we can entry a manual data, or else we can use a web scraping method, sir. So lots of website which has their own data, we can use a web scraping technique to grab those data, sir.
Thank you, Hari and Vishal. Hari, I hope you have collected the data sets for your the COVID-19 visualization project using the web scraping method only, I hope. Is it correct?
Yes, sir. Almost 30% of data from web scraping methods.
Okay. That's a good one. Okay, there is another query. This is a general query. Many of participants are asking whether they need one more session, detailed session about your project. Okay, like what you have done, how you have done about the COVID-19 visualization project. If time permits, they will give another detailed session about what they have done. Okay, that will be conducted in the near future. Okay, we'll update you regarding that. Okay, is there any other questions, dear students? Okay, I think that's it. Okay, over to M.O. Sima. Thank you, Vishal and Hari.
Thank you, sir. And thank you, ma'am.
I call upon Sampath sir for virtual certificate distribution.
Okay, I really appreciate Nikita, Vishal, and today's resource person, Vishal and Hari Krishnamurthy for their wonderful presentation. We really enjoyed your presentation, Mr. Hari and Vishal. And this is the certificate for your certificate for appreciating your effort. This is for Nikita. I hope my screen is visible to you. And this is the certificate for Mr. Hari Krishnamurthy. And this is the certificate for Mr. Visha. I appreciate your wonderful effort for making this event a successful one. And this is the poster for next week webinar. We invite all the audience to join the session next week at 10:40 a.m. without fail. And again, it's over to you, Manikita.
Thank you, sir. Now I welcome Ms. Gayatri ma'am to deliver the vote of thanks.
Before that, just a minute, Gayatri ma'am. And for participants, you will be receiving the participant certificate before today evening. Okay. Please don't forget to fill the feedback link provided in the chat window. Once you fill the feedback, you will be receiving the certificate before end of today evening. Thank you. Over to you, Gayatri ma'am.
Thank you, Sambat sir. So I take this opportunity to appreciate both of them for a very mind-blowing session in the way of their kindness to help our student friends to understand the data science concepts from beginning through stage by stage, and also the relationship between AI, machine learning, and deep learning, and where our data science fits into it. Live example also was really nice to understand the COVID infections in all the countries along with the curve chart. It was really nice, both of you. I wholeheartedly thank our management team, student of CSE, for giving us an opportunity to conduct such a wonderful students webinar series for our students to transfer their knowledge to the other students and make them inspired from both of you. Once again, I thank you all for your active participation. I would require the same support from all of you for the upcoming weeks. That is, every week Saturday, we have our students webinar series with a lot of interesting topics. Thank you all.
அன்பு கிடைத்தது, பண்பு கிடைத்தது, நட்பு கிடைத்தது, கனவு கிடைத்தது, நம்மீஸ்வர் கல்லூரி. இங்கேதான் தெளிவு கிடைத்தது, அறிவு கிடைத்தது, அறமும் கிடைத்தது, நுணுக்கம் கிடைத்தது, நம்மீஸ்வர் கல்லூரி. பசுமை வண்ணம் கொண்ட சூழலிலே மயில்கள் கொண்ட என் கல்லூரியே, ஒற்றுமைக்கும் தேசிய கொடியும் இங்கே கல்லூரியே. அக்கறை கொண்ட நிர்வாகம் அது எங்கள் உத்வேகம், ஆசிரியர்கள் எல்லோரும் வெற்றிகளின் அஸ்திவாரம். ஆதவன் இல்லாமல் அடிகள் ஏது, பாதைகள் இல்லாமல் பயணம் ஏது, கேள்விகள் இல்லாமல் விடைகள் ஏது, ஈஸ்வர் கல்லூரி இல்லாமல் இன்பம் ஏது. கம்யூனிட்டி சென்டர் ஓப்பனர் தியேட்டர், அங்கே உலகம் கற்றுக்கொள்வோமே. நம் காலேஜின் பிளேஸ்மெண்ட் அது என்றும் சூப்பர், அங்கே வேலையும் பெற்றுக்கொள்வோமே. நான்காண்டுகளே என்றாலும் ஒரு குடும்பம் போல வாழ்ந்திடுவோம். 40 ஆண்டுகள் கடந்த பின்னும் நம் கல்லூரி நாட்களை போற்றிடுவோம். இந்த நிலையை நாங்கள் அடைந்தாலும் வாழ்வில் உயர பறந்தாலும் மறவோம் மறவோம் ஒரு நாளும் நாங்கள் ஈஸ்வரில் பயின்ற நாட்களை. ஈஸ்வர் கல்லூரி வாழ்க்கை கற்று தந்த பாடம், காலம் எல்லாம் கண்ணில் நிழலாடும். ஆதவன் இல்லாம பாதைகள் இல்லாம பயணம் ஏது, கேள்விகள் இல்லாம விடைகள் ஏது, ஈஸ்வர் கல்லூரி இல்லாம இன்பம் ஏது.
Okay, again, I thank all the participants for joining us. Please stay home and stay safe.